It's my pleasure to introduce Anke Hensiek. I'm hoping I'm pronouncing her name correctly at the end there. Consultant neurologist. So please come up, Anke, and I'll give you the mic.
Thank you very much. So I'm a general neurologist and I work in the NF2 clinic in Adeenbrookes in Cambridge. So this is going to be a very basic talk. It's not a research talk, but I understand there are lots of patients here who listen. So it may be useful. One of the things I often deal with is neuropathies in NF2. And I was asked to give this talk because I understand there's a lot of confusion about neuropathies and what a neuropathy is, how it affects NF2 patients, and how it is treated. So it's a basic talk. That's what it is about. Next slide, please. So the outline of my presentation will be, the first one will be just a very basic review of neuropathies in general. So not neuropathies specifically related to NF2, but what we see in the general population. What is a neuropathy? How do you diagnose it? How do you classify it? And what causes it? But then I will also specifically talk about neuropathies in NF2, which are different. And then obviously it's important to know how they are treated. Next slide, please. So the first thing is, in order to understand what a neuropathy is, it is important to understand how the nervous system functions. So the nervous system is like a computer, and it works through electricity. So the main computer is obviously the brain, and the nerves are like cables. So the cables really connect, and so all the decisions are made in the brain, all the information from the periphery is collected in the brain, the thinking happens in the brain, and so it's the most important part. And then the nerves are like electrical cables which run from the brain down the spinal cord and then come out at the side of the spinal cord to connect the body with the main computer system. And it all works just like in a computer through electricity. The most important parts of the nervous system clearly are the brain, where everything is happening and where all the nerves are concentrated, and the spinal cord, where all the nerve bundles go down. And so it's like one of the most important parts of the body. And so it has to be protected. So it's protected by bone. So we have the skull of the head protecting the brain, and we've got the spinal column protecting the spinal cord. These are the most important parts of the nervous system, and we call it central nervous system. However, then in order to connect the body with this, the nerves have to come out at the sides. You can see that here, it looks like a little Christmas tree. And those nerve cables, like electrical cables, they kind of go out in the periphery and they're distributed all over the tissue. And they then provide the electrical signal to the body, for example, to the muscles. The muscles get an electrical signal and they know they have to move, and that's how we move. If that nerve doesn't work anymore, we don't have any movement and the muscle withers away. Next slide, please. Oh, and just to say that when we talk about neuropathies, we talk about diseases, not of the brain and the spinal cord, so not of the parts which are basically surrounded by bone and which can be investigated by just doing a scan, but of those nerve cables which are in the tissue and which are diffusely in the tissue, so you can't scan them, you don't see them on a scan. So a neuropathy is a disease of the peripheral nervous system, not of the central nervous system, basically. Next slide, please. So when you think about what happens in a neuropathy, what happens when these nerve cables are damaged, it is important to know what information is actually collected in those nerve cables. So when they are basically cut and don't work anymore, then obviously this function doesn't happen anymore. And there are different things in each nerve cable. So the first thing is, motor information. I said, if there's an electrical signal from the brain going through the nerve cables, we move our hand. So that travels, the information for the motor function travels in the peripheral nerve cables. But also there's information going the other way. So when we touch something, when we feel something, we see if it's hot or cold or something, it travels the other direction. And that's the sensory information, which is fed back to the brain. So the brain, for example, if there's something hot, the brain knows, oh, I have to move away because, it's a dangerous situation. So this is how the brain gets the information. If that function is lost, the brain doesn't get any information. So it just feels numb or sometimes it also just feels abnormal, funny, but the sensory information is not normal. And then finally, all the nerves also have some kind of fibers which are relevant for autonomic function, which is something which happens automatically in the body, which we don't even realize. So for example, controlling our blood pressure, controlling our sexual function, our bladder function, our bowel function. So each nerve has kind of information about all these information. And when it's cut, then whatever is provided by this nerve doesn't work anymore. Next function. Next slide, please. And so when we look at neuropathies, there are different types of neuropathies essentially. So first of all, many neuropathies don't affect all those nerve fibers. Some just affect the sensory function and lead to numbness. Some just affect the motor function and lead to weakness. Some affect just autonomic function. So we can divide it according to this. But we also divide neuropathies according to the distribution in terms of what they provide and which how they are affected. So the most common type of neuropathy in the general population is a degenerative neuropathy, where the nerve ends gradually degenerate. And that starts in the longest nerve cable, so in the feet and the toes, and then gradually creeps up. And you can see that here on the picture here. What results as an end result is that patients just have a kind of gradual onset of gradually progressive distal numbness and potentially weakness. And it looks a bit like a kind of glove and stocking. So that's the most common type of neuropathy, not in NF2, but in the general population. There are other neuropathies as well. Can you just go back one slide? Which just affect not all the nerves, but just one nerve. And that's particularly relevant for NF2. So if just one nerve is cut or doesn't function anymore, like in NF2, if there's a tumor pressing on that nerve, then it is just that nerve that's affected, which doesn't work anymore. That's called mononeuropathy, as you can see here. We classify according to time course, how acute the injury is, and we also classify according to how severe the injury is. Sometimes a nerve doesn't function anymore just to, as you know, sometimes here it's a funny bone, just because you bang it or you stretch it, but it doesn't mean that it's permanently damaged. Whilst on the other end of the spectrum, you kind of completely cut a nerve and then it's permanently damaged and difficult to recover. Next slide, please. So talking about the general population, the most common type of neuropathy is this type, what I just said before, this polyneuropathy, which is a degenerative neuropathy, which also occurs in NF2, but particularly in the general population. So, and very often this just affects the sensory function and not the motor function. So patients have numbness, but no weakness, as you can see here. So a polyneuropathy, is very common and much more common the older you get. I think about 1 in 10 people over the age of 55 have evidence of a polyneuropathy in the general population unrelated to NF2. And so in the general population, if we see patients with a neuropathy, then we have to think about the cause. As I said, the most common cause is that this is just something that happens as you get older, like everything degenerates and so do the nerve cables. And there's no obvious other cause other than getting older. And that's the case in about a third of patients with a neuropathy. However, the second most common cause is diabetes. So patients with diabetes have a high risk of nerve damage. 30% of patients with a neuropathy have diabetes. And then there are lots of other causes, vitamin deficiencies, especially vitamin B. Alcohol is bad for the nerves, that can cause a neuropathy if you drink too much. Inflammatory disorders, rare conditions, inherited conditions, some medications, cancer treatments, lots of causes for neuropathies. And that's really relevant for the general population, but actually it's important to also think about that in NF2 because it could be a contributing factor which could make patients' symptoms worse. Okay, next slide, please. Next slide, please. Okay, so this is the general overview of what a neuropathy is. But we now talk about a neuropathy in NF2. And obviously in NF2, next slide, please. This kind of degenerative polyneuropathy can occur, but is much less common. The most common type of neuropathy in NF2 is that there's nerve damage related to the peripheral nerve tumors. So the most common neuropathy in NF2 is a mononeuropathy, where there's a tumor. The thing is, with those peripheral tumors, unlike the brain and the spinal cord, which are surrounded by bone, so there's no space for tumors to grow, it's different in the peripheral nervous system. So if you have a tumor in the periphery, in your muscles or something, it can often grow outwards and does not necessarily cause damage to the nerves, but often it does. So still, the most common cause of a neuropathy in NF2 is to have a mononeuropathy due to compression by one tumor. And then you can kind of see the tumor and you can see where the deficit is. Next slide, please. Yeah, this is just another example. So basically, it just affects this one tumor, and this one tumor can't provide the information of whatever it distributes. So you have a kind of sensory loss in that area of the nerve supplied by that tumor, and you have a pattern of weakness in those muscles just supplied just by this nerve. Next slide, please. Okay, so that's one cause, and the most common cause of neuropathy is in NF2. However, what we have found and what has persistently been shown is that there's a small proportion of patients, and I have a few in my own clinic, where you see peripheral neurological damage that cannot be explained by a tumor. And this peripheral damage can, for example, be a gradual motor deficit. So I have a few patients who just develop gradual wasting and weakness of one limb, but just deteriorates slowly. And there's no tumor we can link to that. Or some people have really bad peripheral neuropathies, which are just generalized, and you can't really link it to a specific tumor. And for some patients, that's actually the most disabling part of their disease. It's not very common, but it definitely exists. I definitely see it, you know, in a proportion of my patients. And in one of the studies, it was estimated to occur in about 6% of patients. So a kind of clinically detectable neurological deficit, but there's no tumor causing it. However, then in addition to that, it's also been observed, and we see it all the time, that, for example, patients with NF2 don't have reflexes. And it's difficult to explain why they don't have reflexes, and very often that is not linked to tumors. They may not have symptoms of a neuropathy, and they may not have, you know, sensory loss or weakness, but when you examine them, they don't have reflexes. They don't notice, it doesn't bother them, but it's still interesting to think about why that would happen. And it hasn't been studied properly, but the biggest study was done by Oliver Hahnemann, which was published in Brain, one of the main neurology journals. And he has examined patients, even if they didn't have any peripheral neuropathy symptoms, with electrical studies. And he found that actually about 2/3 of patients he examined with these electrical studies have evidence of peripheral nerve damage. So the peripheral nerves don't seem to be functioning normally in NF2, irrespective of the tumors, and it's not really clear why that is. Oliver in his paper speculated that maybe they're like kind of tiny tumor outlets which you can't see, but I think that seems unlikely. You know, it has to be minimal if you can't see it. Or maybe the Merlin mutations don't just cause tumors, but maybe they also affect the way the nerve cells, the peripheral nerve cells work, but it's not really clear why that is. So it's an interesting area to study further. Next one. Yeah, and so in summary, the NF2 specific neuropathy symptoms are usually caused by a nerve specific compression of one tumor. So it's mononeuropathy. A small number of patients have neurological symptoms of a neuropathy, which can't be explained by a tumor. And quite a large patients have subclinical peripheral nerve damage, which you can detect when you test for it, but which is clinically otherwise not evident. And the next slide, please. And then I just really briefly wanted to talk about what we do when we see somebody with a peripheral neuropathy in clinic. What is the management of a peripheral neuropathy? Next slide, please. So the first important thing of the management really is to kind of try to define what kind of neuropathy does this patient have. So according to what I said in the first part of my talk, is it a polyneuropathy, is it a mononeuropathy? And then if it's a mononeuropathy, see if there's a tumor that could cause that. And the way we kind of define that is by taking good history, examining the patient, and sometimes we also do electrical studies of the nerves. Next slide, please. Once we have identified what type of neuropathy it is, we have to obviously see if there's any treatable cause. Is there any kind of tumor causing the nerve compression, which could be potentially taken out? Is there anything systemic in this patient's blood that could worsen the neuropathy? Does he have a history of diabetes or vitamin deficiencies? Or are there any medications? And potentially just look for everything that can be treated, essentially. That's the most important thing. Yeah, next slide. But very often, unfortunately, either the tumors can't be taken out, or it's difficult to take them out, or there's nothing we can identify that can be treated. And in those situations, the management is to manage the symptoms. And it is really important to manage patients in a holistic way in that sense. You know, it's one of the most important things is to just explain to patients what they have and how it could affect them. For example, you know, if they have numbness of their feet, they can become more unsteady, they have a risk of falling, they should wear shoes because they can't really feel their feet, so they could injure them. Those kind of basic things, physiotherapy, balance training. Next slide, please. And then the last thing, I think you already had a talk about pain, so I'm not going to dwell on this, but neuropathies can be very painful. They don't just cause loss of sensations, but it's just, and you know, when you have an electrical flickering light, you know, it's just the sensation is not normal, and that can be quite unpleasant. You know, some patients have pins and needles, some patients have burning pain, some patients have like shooting electrical pains, and that can be really disabling for many patients. It's important to treat the pain. It's important to kind of think about the neuropathic pain may go along with other types of pain because patients often can't walk normally. They may have musculoskeletal things. So it's important to define the type of pain a patient has because the treatment is different for neuropathic pain from other types of pain. Next slide, please. Yeah, and then, as I said, holistic management, pain can really be, you know, affect quality of life in many ways, in a very bad way. So it's important to manage patients in all aspects and just be aware how disabling it can often be to have a very painful peripheral neuropathy. Next slide. So there are a lot of non-pharmacological management options for rather than just giving patients medication for pain treatment in neuropathy. So some patients have these TENS machines, can have acupuncture, psychological treatments. Some patients take supplements, CBD oil I put on there. Some patients say that helps. Next slide, please. But very often it's the case that patients need to be given medication. And for nerve pain, really, normal painkillers don't work. Nerve pain is caused in a way by too much electrical or abnormal electrical signal in the nerves. So medications which influence that, which are often also used for epilepsy, for example, you know, that's why how epilepsy treatment works. It kind of just calms down the excitability of the nerves, and simplistically spoken. So those types of medications often work much better. And there's and sometimes it's good to go to a pain clinic, but there are a range of medications that can be used for nerve pain, but which usually work better than just normal painkillers. And next slide, please. And that's it.